Greetings, my esteemed Laddingtons. Shout out to my man, Jean, for gifting me this fine game. Very heartfelt and appreciated. So, first and foremost, I have a question for all English guys and, well, everyone who's interested in English history. When you meditate and contemplate on the Wars of the Roses, which side are you on? Are you on the Lancaster side or the York side? Let me know in the comment section below. It's of utmost importance that we discuss this this interesting topic. Now I thought to, before I begin to get into the actual gameplay, I would like to give a book recommendation, and that is Conny Gilden's series on the War of the Roses, the Wars of the Roses. Good stuff. I always recommend everything he writes. I have read almost all of his books. I have one book which I bought immediately upon seeing that it was released, but I have saved it. It's set in ancient Greece, so I can't read it now in winter. I'm checking in from Jotunheim, glorious snow landscape, but I must wait until reading this book, until Helios comes back in force, so I can sit outside in the sun with a good cup of coffee and read that book. So I'm savoring it. I'm saving it for a good occasion. Anyway, long story short, if you want a good series on that time, I can definitely recommend Conny Gilden. Another good British author, Bernard Cornwell. I recommend his work, his books before. I'll do it again. Now, of course, the Uhtred series might be his most famous one, but he has also written about the Hundred Years War, similar to this time as well, so the late Middle Ages. Now, why do I mention all of these things now, you wonder? Yes, because Edward Longshanks, he's a bit before, so you see there in the description, it's 1264 to 1307. And also, last thing before I begin to get into this, the gameplay, a TV series recommendation. It's based on books by Philippa Gregory. It's called The White Princess and The White Queen. Quite good, actually. Available at HBO. Obviously not a service I recommend per se, but they had it there at least. And worthwhile watching. I can definitely recommend those two seasons. The only thing I need to strongly object to was a sequence where they visit the Spanish court. Now, of course, the Spanish court descended from Visigoths. And the princess, they are there to make a match for their son to marry the Spanish princess. She erupts into a flamenco dance. And I can assure you that no Spanish royalty would have erupted into a flamenco dance. It was something that detracted quite a bit from the quality of the series. It was, yeah, not good in the least. I am a great friend and admirer of Spanish history and culture, so I need to defend Spain's good name and say that royalty did absolutely not dance flamenco dances. Anyway, that being said, the rest of the series is quite good. The third season is an absolute catastrophe, but I won't blackpill you by talking more about that. Anyway, this particular DLC, you have a new civilization, the Burgundians. I won't get into the Grand Dukes now, maybe for a coming video, who knows, depending on how popular this one is. Then you have the Hautevilles. I don't know how you pronounce it. To my great shame, I do not speak French. Highly barbaric of me. I must redeem myself by praying extra hard in the Temple of Iron. I read German. That was my language in school. You could choose between a few different languages. The most common ones were French, Spanish, and German. Anyway, this might be an interesting topic for a podcast, talking about the Normans. So you see here, Robert de Hauteville left Normandy in 1047 with a small robber band. Allow me to translate it. He left Normandy with a heroic menerbund of glorious shield brothers, and they sought to mug others. That's the actual story. But in all seriousness, though, the most famous Norman, of course, William the Conqueror, conquered merry old England in 1066. But were quite adventurous, these guys. Vikings imbued with a high level of thumos that made them conquer and explore. I will talk about it in another video, in a podcast, going through the history of the Normans. We can derive inspiration from them. So anyway, that might also be for a coming video if there is any interest in it. Let's get into Edward Longshanks, and you probably recognize this name. He's the villain in Braveheart when you see this time period from the perspective of the Scots. He is the villain. You can also read about many good books about Robert the Bruce as well. You have a British author, Robin Young, female author, written great books on this time as well from the perspective of Scots. Can definitely recommend it. Anyway, let's get into the campaign. So we have here Merry Old England, and we'll travel to Wales, Scotland, and to the Holy Land. So let's get into it. Vain ambition. Boom.
It is the curse of all royalty to be compared with their forebears. My illustrious father built himself a kingdom in his youth. Now I can barely hold on to it in mine. I hear all of the nobility's whisperings at court. They say that I may be king of England by birth, but I will never be so by merit. That I, Edward II, am unworthy of my father's name. How much longer until these whispers become cries of rebellion? My heart quivers when I visit his tomb in the abbey. I am racked by fear. Claws at my soul like the talons of demons. Fear that I will prove them right, that I will disgrace this family's legacy, as my grandfather did. Yet I must not give in. I will study my father's reign, and hope that it will imbue me with his strength, the fortitude that I so lack. My father, Edward, spent his youth watching in disgust as his ineffectual father, Henry, drove England to the brink of ruin. When his subjects could bear his ruinous reign no more, a rebellion led by the Baron Simone de Montfort deposed Henry, leaving his kingdom in tatters. After the disastrous Battle of Lewes, the baronial forces captured and jailed my father and grandfather in Hereford. Some kings begin their rise to the throne from within the palace. Edward began his from the anguish of imprisonment. Yet even when the future seems bleak, fate occasionally extends its hand and offers allies from the most unlikely of places.
All right, as always in Age of Empires, epic and atmospheric introductions. So now we're in the game. Edward Longshanks must survive, and Gilbert de Clare must survive. Again, excuse my French if I mispronounce it. I hope I pronounce it correctly. My man, the extremely aesthetic Guillaume, can tell me how my French pronunciation is. Anyway, let's get into it.
Come, Lord Edward. Let us make haste and escape whilst the town lies asleep.
Ready.
Let us do so. Edward Longshanks. And a note here, this aesthetics, these three golden English lions, Norman lions, absolute aesthetic. Need to make some sort of Legio Gloria garment. Yes. On a similar note, do let me know also in the comment section who your favorite English king might be. Who's the most interesting or inspiring or whatever. I always read the comments in Let's Play videos. Yay. We must mog these new males. There were quite many. I need to run around with them a bit so they can mog these guys. I might also edit this video a little bit. To make it more exciting, I suppose. These guys, they want to question the validity of my claim to the English throne, is what Edward says here.
Yay.
The reason I am more responsive on Let's Play videos is that the overall amount of comments much less, so I can have the opportunity to respond to more of them. Otherwise, I usually feel quite bad if I only respond to some comments. Now, of course, on Gabmine's Patreon Subscribestar, I'm always very responsive.
Your loyalty will not be forgotten, Gilbert. Let us hurry to Worcester, raise an army, and pay these arrogant barons the wages of treachery.
This might be the thumbnail for the video. This aesthetics, the red and then golden lions on it. Absolutely aesthetically pleasing. Aha, we have some other blasphemous enemies here. We need to avoid them. If we can. I'm not sure we can, actually. Aha, one saw us. Right, turn around, lads, and illuminate this bastard. Also, a note on the music. It's very literally speaking music to my ears. Since I grew up with this soundtrack, said Age of Empires. I've said it before. I'll say it again. Age of Empires, both Age of Empires 2 and Age of Mythology, are sacred to me. I am extremely thankful for growing up with them. Extremely thankful for the interest in history they supplied me with. And yeah, sacred games. I'm sure many of you feel the same way if you've grown up with it. Good times, good times. We need to fight these guys as well. Out on thin ice here. We can't lose this guy because then we lose the campaign. He needs to survive. He needs to survive the jive. A great channel, which I'm sure you're all fully familiar with. If you're not, search for it and enlighten yourself about pagan history and other good stuff.
Townsmen, prepare the defenses, or Simone de Montfort will have our heads on spikes.
Good stuff, good stuff. So now I will do a little edit here, and I will build up, and I will get right back when I have progressed further in the campaign. So be right back. Alright, so I am back. I did a little edit there, as you noticed, and I decided to do a little boom with my little village here. So I built an additional town center there. And one here, and now I'm gathering some stone to build a castle, since the forces are coming quite soon. So I'll place the castle there, I suppose, and I don't even know if we have enough time to build it. I suppose not. Oh well, I have created a little army that will withstand the onslaught, the baronial forces. So we'll see what is going on now. See, I need to gather some more wood.
So the tall prince has escaped my clutches. For now, I shall assemble the baronial army myself and prove him to be as foolish as his father.
Wales casts its lot in with the barons. We will help you return the brash Longshanks to his cell.
Our holdings in Worcester can support but a small force. We must strike quickly to bring our rivals back into the fold and even the odds.
That is noted. So they didn't actually come to attack us. They expect us to go to them to mug them. That is fine. I suppose that's what we'll have to do. Here is my favorite unique unit, by the way. The English longbowman. Highly joyous to create them. Anyway, I will attack someone, I suppose. The Welsh, perhaps. They need to be subjugated. And we'll see what happens after that. We have reached the Welsh. They're not prepared to face our our army, or maybe they are actually. And I need to make sure that Edward doesn't die here. That would be a bit silly if he does. Maybe I should actually have brought some knights or something. Can go back and create some and send them up. Otherwise we might have a hard time taking down all of their buildings here. Another edit, as you might have noticed. So I subjugated the Welsh, they are now on our side, and now I am putting on some pressure on this Kenilworth. And they're being protected by baronial forces and Simon the Younger. So we need to kill this guy and hopefully get this citadel city over to us. Now we are less than 3 minutes until the baronial forces attack us, and we're gonna see if we can actually conquer this city in that time. I suppose that will reduce the amount of enemies that will come at us. We'll see how that goes. I have a battering ram in addition to my army here of crossbowmen and longbowmen. So the gate is down. Can we make it in time? I don't really suppose we can. But we'll see. We can at least destroy part of their town. Maybe I shouldn't have left the home base unprotected in case they attack, but it's a gamble. We'll see how it turns out. And we have a unit, a sergeant, I haven't seen before. Looking quite aesthetic.
Enough tarrying. My knight, come for you. My Valoros.
Okay, his knights are coming. And we were just a bit too late to destroy this this city. Anyway, let's look over our defenses. We are at population limit here, so we can't really create more soldiers. But if we can, we can train some knights and stuff. I don't really see where this Laddington might be, though. Maybe it comes with a surprise attack. I will then counter with a surprise flex. Hopefully that will get him to abandon his hostility towards us. We'll see.
With their forces in disarray, the rest will be compelled to fall before me and beg for mercy.
Okay, so that was it. We just had to subdue them. I'll press continue.
Like his Norman ancestors, Gilbert de Clare was a shrewd opportunist. Initially a commander in the rebel army, he keenly sensed its divisions and saw that he could further his own ambitions by defecting to Edward. My father moved with alarming speed. Worcester and Gloucester, Gilbert's family seat, were seized without delay. After a string of further victories, he compelled the leaderless and battered rebel forces to capitulate. Known by many as Longshanks, Edward was feared for his imposing stature and foul temper. While Henry was restored to the throne, all were well aware that Edward was now the true power behind it.
Good stuff, good stuff. I thought about ending the episode there, but we're actually going to have a quick look at A Man of God. I think this is the only reasonable course of action, so let's get into it.
Ruthless and cunning, Edward did not always adhere to the chivalric codes that the European nobility held so dear. After massacring Simone the Younger's men in a stealthy night attack on Kenilworth, he used the captured banners to disguise his army before smashing de Mountfort at Evesham. In an act of alarming brutality, The corpse of de Montfort, an Earl of England, was hacked into carrion and his head mounted on a pike. Edward had won the war and cowed the rebels into submission in just over a year. But the victory came at the cost of his honor. Nobility and clergy alike cringed at the thought of an impious butcher one day ascending to the throne of England. To restore his ailing reputation and prove himself worthy of the crown, my father resolved to lead a crusade east to the Holy Land, where the situation grew increasingly dire. The voracious Mamluk Sultanate waged a fierce war of expansion, first against the Mongols and now against the beleaguered Crusaders. Several fortresses quickly fell before their unstoppable onslaught. Their leader was Sultan Baybars, a man not unlike my father, Edward. Originally a slave of Cumin origin, he rose to prominence through military service and had recently taken power after murdering the reigning Sultan. Having just slaughtered the population of Antioch, his armies now threatened Acre and Tripoli from the east, converging on both cities in a suffocating siege. Edward's army arrived in Acre to find the inhabitants desperate, but not beyond hope.
You crusaders have sullied our lands long enough. We will drag you from your castles and into the sea.
Alright, I mainly just wanted to look at that intro. We have a beautiful city here as well we need to defend, but I will actually leave it there for this time, and I will see you all on Telegram, I suppose, if you're not already following me there. Also follow me on Gab and Minds. So, now, thank you for watching. XOXO, boom!